Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillahi nahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nastaghfiruh wa nu'minu bihi wa natawakkalu alayh wa na'udhu billahi min shururi anfusina wa min sayyiati a'malina. Man yahdihillahu fala mudilla lahu wa man yudlil fala hadiya lahu. ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليمًا كثيرًا Dear brothers and sisters, today inshallah we'll talk about Surah Al-Kahf. You know, Surah Al-Kahf is one of the surahs in the glorious Quran. If you look at ayah number 9 in Surah Al-Kahf, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, أَمْ حَسِبْتَ أَنَّ أَصْحَابَ الْكَهْفِ, the people of the cave, the sleepers of the cave, the surah is taking its name from that ayah, أَمْ حَسِبْتَ أَنَّ أَصْحَابَ الْكَهْفِ وَالرَّقِيمِ. Inshallah, I will talk about two things about this surah. Number one, the virtues of this surah. You might have heard that it is virtuous to recite Surah Al-Kahf every Friday. And that's why you see sometimes people at their home, when they are at their businesses, when they come early to the mosque, they recite Surah Al-Kahf. So what is the reason that people recite Surah Al-Kahf, especially on Friday? And what Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam has informed us. There are various ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam regarding this surah. There are ahadith regarding the first 10 ayats, regarding the last 10 ayats, and also there are reports which talk about the first three ayats of Surah Al-Kahf. There's a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He mentions that when Surah Al-Kahf is recited, tranquility descends upon that person at the time of recitation of Surah Al-Kahf. And there's a hadith. In the hadith, there is a story. Abu Ishaq mentions, سَمِعْتُ الْبَرَىٰ إِبْنَ عَازِبٍ, I heard Bara ibn Azib radiyallahu anhu, he mentioned, qara'a rajulun al-kahf, that there was a man who recited Surah Al-Kahf. And then there was an animal in the house. When he was reciting Surah Al-Kahf, the animal which was in the house began acting in a nervous way. Fasallama, he looked around, what is the problem, what is happening? Fa'idha dhababatun aw sahabatun, he saw that there was a fog or a cloud. He could see that there was fog or cloud. غَشِيَتُهُ فَذَكَرَهُ لِلنَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ, he mentioned this story to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and asked him. فَقَالَ, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم told him, اِقْرَأْ فُلَانٌ, or so and so, keep reciting the surah or the glorious Quran. فَإِنَّهَا السَّكِينَةِ, because that is sakina, that is tranquility, نَزَلَتْ لِلْقُرْآنِ, that descends at the time of the recitation of the glorious Quran. Or it came down because of the reading of the glorious Quran. Imam Bukhari and Imam Muslim rahmatullahi alayhima, also at their muhaddithin, have collected this hadith in their collections. So this shows us that when you recite the glorious Quran, especially when we reflect upon the story which is mentioned in this hadith, Surah Al-Kahf, that the man was reciting Surah Al-Kahf and there was a horse or animal that was acting differently in a nervous way. And when the Sahabi saw that what was happening, he saw a cloud or a fog, and then he mentioned to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and then he told the Sahabi that it was the sakina, the tranquility from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When we talk about that tranquility, my brothers and sisters, you might have felt sometimes somebody reciting the glorious Quran, and you will see sometimes that the listeners are crying. And it is everywhere, it's not something that is hidden. Even at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the enemies, They used to come, they used to hide themselves, come to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they used to listen to that recitation of the glorious Quran. Because the Quran is the book of Allah. And when somebody recites, and he recites it in a proper way, the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taught us, or has guided us, the way we have received it from the ulama, from the scholars, from the reciters, if you recite in that way, there is a particular situation at that time that affects you, and also, you know, taqsha'irul qulub. At that time, the hearts start trembling. And so that is the reason that sometimes you see people are crying when they listen or hear the recitation of the glorious Quran. So when we recite the glorious Quran, especially Surah Al-Kahf, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, tranquility descends upon that person or at that time when the Quran is being recited. That teaches us, my brothers and sisters, that at home, at our workplace, we are driving or anywhere, or especially when we are sitting in the masjid, we should not waste our time sitting and, you know, chatting on our phone, or sometimes if you see this thing, or standing outside and just, you know, being busy in idle talk. So we can use that time in the recitation of the glorious Quran, especially which has been instructed by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, recitation of Surah Al-Kahf on Fridays. The first 10 ayahs, Abu Ad-Darda radiyallahu anhu mentions that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Man hafiza 10 ayatin min awwal surati al-kahf usima min ad-dajjal." You might have heard about Dajjal. It will be a big fitna. Your iman, your belief will be tested at that time, and he will try to put you into trials and problems. So at that time Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will test you how strong faith and iman you have. So especially at that time, you will be saved if you have memorized the first 10 ayahs from Surah Al-Kahf. From Alhamdulillah alladhi anzala ala abdihi al-kitaba wa lam yaj'al lahu iwaja. This is the first ayah. And the 10th ayah is, إِذْ أَوَى الْفِتْيَةُ إِلَى الْكَهْفِ فَقَالُوا رَبَّنَا آتِنَا مِنْ لَدُنْكَ رَحْمَةً وَهَيِّئْ لَنَا مِنْ أَمْرِنَا رَشَدًا. Also, there is a report in which Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned, مَنْ قَرَأَ ثَلَاثَ آيَاتٍ, who recited, memorized, three ayahs from Surah Al-Kahf, from the beginning of Surah Al-Kahf, عُصِمَ مِنْ فِتْنَةِ الدَّجَّالِ, he will be protected from the fitna of Dajjal. Also, there is a hadith in which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam guided us that if somebody who memorizes, he recites the last 10 ayahs of Surah Al-Kahf, he will be protected from the fitna of Dajjal. Man qara al-ashr al-awakhir, the last 10 ayahs from Surah Al-Kahf, usima min fitnati Dajjal. Imam Muslim, Nasai, and other muhaddithin have collected this hadith that he will be protected from the Dajjal. There's a hadith in Mustadrak. Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiyallahu anhu is the reporter of this hadith, in which he has narrated from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where he said, "Man qara'a Surat al-Kahf fi yawm al-Jumu'ah." It is especially about the recitation of Surat al-Kahf on Friday. "Man qara'a Surat al-Kahf fi yawm al-Jumu'ah," whoever recites Surat al-Kahf on the day of Jumu'ah, "adha'a lahu minan nur ma bayna al-Jumu'atayn." That will illuminate him with the light from one Friday to the next Friday. My brothers and sisters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will create or will send a light with that will stay with you for the whole week, from this Friday to the next Friday, if you recite Surah Al-Kahf. What is that light? That light is the protection from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That if you sometimes fall in a situation that you might be committing sins, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will protect you from that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will guard you from the shaitan, or things that shaitan might affect your life, or he might deviate you from the true path. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will create a light that will stay with you and that will be protecting you from the mischiefs of from deviating from the true path. That is the light that Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is promising in this. Also, Abu Bakr Ahmad ibn Hussein ibn Ali al-Bayhaqi in Kitab al-Sunan al-Kubra, he mentions a hadith from Abu Hashim. He says that anna nabiy sallallahu alayhi wa sallam qala man qara'a surat al-kahf, whoever recites surat al-kahf kama unzilat, as it was revealed from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, kanat lahu nuran yawm al-qiyamah, there will be a light, special light for that person on the day of resurrection. And my brothers and sisters, on the day of resurrection, you will need the light of the Quran, the light of the verses that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed in the glorious Quran. And everybody needs that light, especially on the day of resurrection, when they will be sad, they will be worried, there will be darkness everywhere, and they will have a lot of problems. So in those situations, you will see the benefit of reciting. There is not a big surah, just a small surah, that if you do it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will create a light in this worldly life as well as in the hereafter. Also important thing which I would like to discuss, and this has been mentioned in a long hadith, muhaddithin have collected, and I am quoting this from Tafsir ibn Kathir. He has mentioned the reason behind the revelation of this surah, Surah Al-Kahf. He says, ذَكَرَ مُحَمَّدُ بْنُ إِسْحَاقُ سَبَبَ نُزُولِ. Muhammad ibn Ishaq has mentioned the reason behind the revelation of Surah Al-Kahf. فَقَالَ, and he says, حَدَّثَنِي شَيْخٌ مِّنْ أَهْلِ مِصْرِ, an old man came from Misr, from Egypt. قَدِمَ عَلَيْنَا مُنْدُ بِضْعٍ وَأَرْبَعِينَ سَنَةٍ, 40 or some years before he came. And he narrated, reported this from Ikrama, and from Ikrama he narrated from Ibn Abbas. And Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma mentioned this, بَعَثَتْ قُرَيْشٌ نَظْرَ بْنَ الْحَارِثُ وَعُقْبَةَ بْنَ أَبِي مُعَيْطٍ. What happened if, when we look at history, at the biography of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the halat, the situation and the condition of Muslims at the time of Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In the beginning, he was conveying Allah's message silently, hiding himself and then conveying, calling his relatives, his close friends and other people. And it was a secret da'wah from Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When he was commanded from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to go openly, he started calling people towards Islam. And you could see the reaction from the disbelievers, from the people of Makkah, especially from Quraysh, that they were not ready to accept it. And to stop from Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from doing da'wah, from conveying the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they tried their best, everything. They offered mal, they offered girls, they offered mamlaka, they offered everything which was possible for them. And they tried to their best to stop him from conveying the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They tried to kill him, they hurt him, they threw stones at him, they cursed him. And that's why you see that the immigration, hijrah from Makkah, the first time it took place, and the people went to Habasha. Then the second time they went from Makkah to Medina. And then at Medina, what was the situation? Some people welcomed them, but there were some people who were against. And especially the Quraysh of Makkah and the disbelievers at Makkah, they were spreading rumors everywhere about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or what was he was saying. So what happened? Quraysh ba'athat an-Nadhr ibn al-Harith wa Uqbah ibn Abi Mu'ayt. These two people were sent by Quraysh to Medina. They said, they were sent ila ahbar Yahud bil Medina. In Medina, there were rabbis of the Yahud. So these two people were sent by Quraysh to the rabbis of the Yahud. Faqalu lahum. And they told those two people that you go there and saluhum an Muhammad. You ask those rabbis about Prophet Muhammad. Wasifu lahum sifatah. And you describe the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to them, to those rabbis who are in Medina. Waqbiruhum biqawli. And you tell them, inform them about what he says. فَإِنَّهُمْ أَهْلُ الْكِتَابِ الْأَوَّلِ, because they are the people of the first book. وَعِنْدَهُمْ مَا لَيْسَ عِنْدَنَا مِنْ عِلْمِ الْأَنْبِيَاءِ, they have more knowledge than we have about the prophets, or the knowledge of the prophets. فَخَرَجَ حَتَّى قَدِيمَ الْمَدِينَةِ, these two people, Nadhr ibn al-Harith and Uqba ibn Abi Mu'ayt, they went to Medina. فَسَأَلُوا أَحْبَارَ يَهُودَ عَنْ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ, they asked the Yahud something about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَوَصَفُوا لَهُمْ أَمْرَهُ وَبَعْضَ قَوْلِهِ, And they mentioned about his mission, that this is what he is doing, and this is what he is saying, some of those things. وَقَالَ إِنَّكُمْ أَهْلُ التَّوْرَةِ. Those two people, they told the rabbis that you are the people of the Torah. وَقَدْ جِئْنَاكُمْ لِتُخْبِرُونَ عَنْ صَحَابِنَا هَذَا. And we came to you with a purpose, that you can inform us about the companion of ours. قَالَ فَقَالَتْ لَهُمْ. The rabbis told them, سَلُوهُ عَنْ ثَلَاثٍ نَأْمُرُكُمْ بِهِنَّ. That when you two guys, when you go back, you ask him about three things. And those three things have been mentioned in this surah, in Surah Al-Kahf. Inshallah, I will talk about that. سَلُوهُ عَنْ ثَلَاثٍ نَأْمُرُكُمْ بِهِنَّ. We tell you about three things, you go back and ask about those three things from Prophet Muhammad. فَإِنْ أَخْبَرَكُمْ بِهِنَّ. فَهُوَ نَبِيٌّ مُرْسَلٌ. If he informs you about those three things, then he is a prophet from Allah. وَإِنْ لَمْ يَفْعَلْ فَالرَّجُلُ مُتَقَوِّلٌ فَرَوْ فِيهِ رَأْيَكُمْ. And if he does not inform you, then he is somebody who has made up all those things, and he is saying these things from his own self. فَرَوْ فِيهِ رَأْيَكُمْ. Then it is up to you what you decide about him, or what you do, or how you deal with him. سَلُوهُ عَنْ فِتْيَةٍ ذَهَبُوا فِي الدَّهْرِ الْأَوَّلِ. The three questions that the rabbis told those two people, Nadr ibn al-Harith and Uqbah ibn Abi Mu'ayyid, to be asked from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The first question was عَنْ فِتْيَةٍ, about a group of people who went to the cave, فِي الدَّهْرِ الْأَوَّلِ, in ancient times. And these are the Ashabul Kahf. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about them, their qualities, their belief in Surah Al-Kahf. When you recite this Surah Al-Kahf, you try to understand, you will get the story and the lesson that you are learning from that story. The second question, فَإِنَّهُمْ قَدْ كَانَ لَهُمْ وَسَلُوهُ عَنْ رَجُلٍ طَوَّافٍ. Ask him about a rajul, about a man who traveled a great deal. He reached the east and the west. And this is Dhul Qarnayn, يَسَأَلُونَكَ عَنْ ذِي الْقَرْنَيْنِ قُلْ سَأَتْلُوا عَلَيْكُمْ مِنْهُ ذِكْرًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about. مَا كَانَ نَبَأُهُ. What was his story? وَسَأَلُوهُ عَنِ الرُّوحِ. And ask him about ruh. What is ruh? مَا هُوَ. فَإِنْ أَخْبَرَكُمْ بِذَلِكَ فَهُوَ نَبِيٌّ اتَّبِعُوهُ. If he informs you and tells you the answers for these three questions, then he is a true prophet and you follow him. وَإِنْ لَمْ يُخْبِرْكُمْ فَإِنَّهُ رَجُلٌ مُتَقَوِّلٌ. If he does not inform you, then he is a Nabi, or he is somebody who has made all those things from his own side. What happened next? فَأَقْبَلَ النَّضْرُ وَعُقْبَةُ حَتَّى قَدِمَ عَلَى قُرَيْشٍ. They came back from Medina to Mecca. فَقَالَ يَا مَعْشَرُ قُرَيْشٍ. And they informed the Quraysh about what happened with them when they went to Medina and talked to the rabbis of the Yahud. قَدْ جِئْنَاكُمْ بِفَصْلٍ مَا بَيْنَكُمْ وَبَيْنَ مُحَمَّدٍ. They told the Quraysh that we came with our decisive solution that will end up the problems which you have between you and between Muhammad. قَدْ أَمَرَنَا أَحْبَارُ يَهُودٍ أَنْ نَسْأَلَهُ عَنْ أُمُورٍ. The Yahud, the rabbis told us to ask the Prophet Muhammad about some important things. فَأَخْبَرُوهُمْ بِهَا. Then they told the Quraysh about those three things. فَجَاءُوا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. They came to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and he started asking, يَا Muhammad. O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, akhbirna, tell us. Fasa'aluhu amma amaruhum bi. And they asked him those three questions, what they were told from the rabbis. Faqala lahum Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ukhbirukum ghadan bima sa'altum anhu. When they asked those three questions, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not respond immediately. What he said, I will tell you the answer for these questions tomorrow. And what he did not say, inshallah. وَلَا تَقُولَنَّ لِشَيْءٍ إِنِّي فَعَلٌ ذَلِكَ غَدَى إِلَّا أَنْ يَشَاءَ اللَّهُ. That when you say something, you are going to do it, always say, inshallah, that if Allah wills, I will do that. Otherwise, because my brothers and sisters, everything is in Allah's hand. He said, I will tell you tomorrow, but he didn't say, inshallah. What happened? You see, next, وَلَيْسَ يَسْتَثْنِي. That he didn't say, inshallah. فَصَرَفُوا عَنْهُ. They came back from the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. وَمَكَثَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صلى الله عليه وسلم خَمْسَ عَشَرَةَ لَيْلَةً. He stayed for 15 days and wahi did not come. Jibreel عليه الصلاة والسلام did not bring anything as wahi from Allah سبحانه وتعالى. حَتَّى أَرْجَفَ أَهْلُ مَكَّةَ. People of Mecca started doubting that Maybe he is telling lie now. That's why he promised us that he will tell us tomorrow, and 15 days gone, and he is not ready with the answer. Hatta arjafa ahlu Makkah, they started doubting. وَقَالُوا وَعَدَنَا مُحَمَّدٌ غَدًا, he told that he will inform tomorrow. وَالْيَوْمُ خَمْسَ عَشَرَةَ, and today the 15 days is starting. قَدْ أَصْبَحْنَا فِيهَا, starting. لَا يُخْبِرُنَا بِشَيْءٍ عَنْهُ عَمَّا سَأَلْنَاهُ عَنْهُ, he didn't inform anything what we have asked him. وَحَتَّى أَحْزَنَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ مَكْثُ الْوَحْيِ عَنْهُ, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was also feeling sad because of the stop in revelation, and the revelation did not come. And Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam promised that he would tell them tomorrow, because he believed that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will inform him about those things. وَشَقَّ عَلَيْهِ مَا تَكَلَّمُ بِهِ أَهْلُ مَكَّةِ, he was very grieved about what people of Mecca were saying about him. ثُمَّ جَاءَهُ جِبْرِيلُ, at that time Jibril alayhi salatu wasalam came, مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, بِسُورَةِ أَصْحَابِ الْكَهْفِ, about the surah, with the surah of Ashab al-Kahf. Fiha mu'atabatuhu iyyahu ala husnihi wa alayhim. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala consoled the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that you don't have to worry about that. We are informing you about that. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the surah. Wakhaba ruma sa'aluhu anhu min amri al-fityah wal-rajul al-tawwaf wa qawlillahi azza wa jal wa yas'alunaka anil ruh. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told everything and revealed everything about those three questions in this surah. So this is the reason behind the revelation of this surah, Suratul Kahf. My brothers and sisters, when we talk about the subject and the theme of this surah, if you find, you will see that in the beginning of the surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is praising himself, that he is the one who has revealed the glorious Quran. There is no doubt, there is no confusion, it is not restored and it is not changed, and there is nothing, no problem in that. That is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is praising himself, that it is Allah who has revealed it and there is no doubt. And behind that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is proving that the Prophet whom we have given this book, he is a true prophet and he has been sent from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whatever those disbelievers, they want a proof for being a true prophet, that's why they are asking these questions. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is consoling the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that you don't have to worry about that and everything is with you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about Ashab al-Kahf, and when we look at the ayahs, you will find out that these were the people. نَحْنُ نَقُصُّ عَلَيْكَ نَمَاهُمْ بِالْحَقِّ إِنَّهُمْ فِتْيَةٌ آمَنُوا بِرَبِّهِمْ وَزِدْنَاهُمْ هُدَى, we made their hearts firm and strong with the light of faith in Allah, and bestow upon them patience to bear the separation of their kith and kin and dwellings. And the story, if you look at that, my brothers and sisters, their condition was like the condition of those persecuted Muslims at the time of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They were being punished, they were being, you know, harmed, they were being killed, they were being, you know, disturbed in their prayers and in their activities and everything. So the same situation was with those Ashab al-Kahf, and they fled from there, and they were in the cave. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala dealt with them in whatever was suitable for them. Also, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala importantly talks about two people in this surah. وَضْرِبْ لَهُمْ مَثَلَ الرَّجُلَيْنِ جَعَلْنَا لِأَحَدِهِمَا جَنَّتَيْنِ مِنْ أَعْنَابٍ وَحَفَفْنَاهُمَا بِنَخْلٍ وَجَعَلْنَا بَيْنَهُمَا زَرْعًا. Special, those two people, they were given gardens with grapes and everything. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestowed upon them. But one was the perfect believer and the other was a disbeliever. The believer, he said that everything is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When he used to go to his garden, he used to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the other one, who was a disbeliever, he used to say that it is because of me, it is because of my hard work, and it is because of which is in fact, my brothers and sisters, unthankfulness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also, Allah mentions the story of Khidr. It's a long story. If you remember, Musa alayhi salatu wasalam one day stood up to deliver a speech, and it was a very eloquent speech. And somebody asked, "Oh Musa, the Prophet of Allah, who is most knowledgeable person on the surface of the earth?" And Musa alayhi salatu wasalam said, "It is me." Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala admonished Prophet Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, revealed to him and told him that no, go to some place, Majma'ul Bahrain. You go there, you will find a slave of ours, and you learn from him. And then the journey of learning and teaching is started, and whatever happened, you can see. And also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about Dhul Qarnain. However, my brothers and sisters, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, may he enable us to understand the glorious Quran, to have the deep understanding of the glorious Quran, to get lessons and implement those stories and those things which we learn from the glorious Quran in our life. May Allah accept our prayers, our recitations, our ibadat. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put love and muhabba in our heart. May Allah make us firm on the straight path, which is Siratul Mustaqim. Wa akhiru da'wana. And alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. We have 5 minutes for sunnah.